All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's 8:30. I might be being here. You see, we've got suits on this side, no suits on this side. Don't fight. All right, call meeting to order. And Director Green, you are first up with committee report on finance. Well, today's a lovely day. Pray for rain.
No light.
It is going to rain today.
All right, I'll get the safety briefing. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. It's going to be a little time.
Yeah.
So obviously we're on the ninth floor on the west part of the building. In the event that we need to exit this building or this room here, we can actually go the elevators, go all the way down to the main floor one. Or star on the elevator, and then we would exit on the 17th Street side of the building. In the event of a fire, we would use the steps and walk all the way down to the main level, exit on the 17th Street side. There's a fire extinguisher right here. There's also another one in the hallway. The AD and the first aid kit are one on top of each other, just to the right of the elevator. If you have a medical condition, please write it down or tell your neighbor. Is anybody here certified in the use of an AED or in CPR? There are some here. Okay. So very good. Mark, would you call 911 in the event that we need it? And I think that is it for the safety briefing. Any questions of the safety briefing?
Okay. Thank you.
Very good.
We have this month we have three reporting items and one action item. First reporting item is
look at the graphs contained in your packet. I'll walk you through the different cost and revenue categories. First, looking at revenues for May on the retail side was $68.3 million, which is $1.2 million or 1.7% under budget. Year to date was $1.6 million or 0.5% over budget. Look at our off system revenues. For May, there were $15.5 million, which is $0.8 million or 5.2% under budget. Year to date, with $69.4 million, which is $10.5 million under budget. Year to date. Turning to expenses, O&M expenses excluding fuel and purchase power for May were $44.1 million, which is $3.3 million under budget. Year to date, non-fuel O&M is $219.6 million, which is $9.2 million under budget. Fuel and purchase power side for May was $22.9 million, which was $1.1 million under budget. Year to date, we're $113.2 million, which is $3.5 million under budget. So basically, if you look at the revenues and expenses, basically offset each other. If you look at the net income for May, it's a loss of $1.4 million, which is $2.2 million over budget. Year to date, we have a loss of $22.8 million, which is $2.3 million over budget. We're still projecting that $39.8 million. This is our capital expenditures for May, which is $16.4 million. $3.8 million under budget. Year to date, capital is $85.1 million, which is $0.8 million under budget. On the cash side, our unrestricted cash at the end of May is $308.7 million, which is $23.7 million. Any questions on
that? Talk a little bit about the wholesale revenue, the off-system revenue piece of it. It was a great conversation we had this day, so it's kind of where we see it here today, and then the impact of that is relative to the cost initiative that we have going on. It's kind of bridging that, so to speak.
Okay. If you look at our off-system sales, year to date, year to date for
Casey's sitting right there.
Stay accurate. And you don't have to leak halfway through.
If you look at off-system sales, for the month, we sold 20% more than we projected to sell, but the price was 26.7% below the budget. So we're selling more at a lower price, and therefore the revenue for the forecast. That story holds for the month and for the year. So we're continuing to see low unit prices and continuing to sell the revenue we project. The positive side of that story is the energy that we're purchasing, fuel and purchase out of fossil fuel, because we're also purchasing at a price less than we projected to purchase for the family and purchasing more. So we've got a little bit of offset there, but the variance on the sales side is more impactful than the savings on the purchase side. The other thing that I'll point out is if you look at the revenue for today, May for us is a transitional month for heat and cooling because of the weather that it varies. And if we look at year to date, on heat and cooling, they're 14% lower than which means it's going to be higher. Year to date, we're 14% lower than cooling, which means it's going to be higher than cooling. We know the weather of the last week and this week is probably up, so we'll see how that plays out for us. But year to date is good. So as we work on this, revenue reduction, that we see an offset, and we continue to look at cost reductions throughout the organization through the development of ways to look out through the budget, but also the revenue, right? And we're seeing some of those cost reductions. So that's helping a lot of the real problem.
Any other questions?
How much is the PCCM? Thank you.
their list and their
So strategic directive 15, which was approved by the board in July, basically says that OPPD shall maintain an enterprise risk management program, form an independent oversight function of the district's risk management activities to ensure significant risk identified, assessed, managed, and reported. Organizational policies, procedures, and processes to maintain risk exposures within agreed upon risk tolerance levels. With this strategic directive, we have four principles that are outlined. So I'm going to respond to each of these four principles as I walk through the information. The first principle is ensure the district is maintaining an ERM program that fulfills this policy. So as mentioned, we have strategic directive 15. We also have an internal enterprise risk management policy. Those two outline how we accomplish the directive that we have been assigned. We also have oversight committees in the organization. We have three committees, and I'll provide just a diagram in just a moment. It shows how it all fits together. But we have three oversight committees that are cross-functional in nature that meet on a monthly basis to oversee, discuss risk, and then decide the risk level and then escalation criteria that would be applied within that category. As I just mentioned, these risk committees meet monthly, and they have at least one member from each business unit on the committee. So it is a cross-functional perspective around discussing the risk. On a quarterly basis, the items that were identified through those committees are escalated to the committee, which is made up of senior management, and their items that go to that committee are then either retained by senior management or escalated to the board based on risk classifications. Providing an overview of the process or the structure, if you look at the bottom, you can see that we have the ERM working group committees. There are three. The first one on the left is the system management committee, and it basically mirrors responsibilities outlined in the board governance process for the system management committee and also the nuclear oversight committee. So those two are combined internally in the organization under system management ERM committee. We have the finance, insurance, and audit responsibilities that report into a single committee internally. And then we have governance and public information that also is combined into one group. And as mentioned, those three meet monthly. That information is escalated to the executive ERM committee. And through that process, it comes to you on a quarterly basis. You just receive the information. Just a review of where we have come from and where we are today. As I mentioned earlier, we approved Strategic Directive 15 in July of last year. We have provided this report on a quarterly basis, so this is the fourth report that's been provided. To give you an idea of how the prioritization works, we have a matrix, which is color-coded on the left-hand side. We have severity from a low of a ranking of 1 to extreme of 4, and then you have frequency or probability of occurrence from unlikely, which is a 1, to probable, which is a 4. Those items that are on the list that you reviewed are the items that are contained up in those three
red boxes at the top right-hand corner, which means you're a larger, more significant risk, and there's a higher probability of occurrence. The boxes that are shown in orange are those items that are retained by the senior management team and the executive guardian committee. The yellow items are basically retained at the working group level. On the right is just an example of the sheet that you just received outlining those risks. When necessary, request additional explanation of the risk from the corresponding vice president responsible for the risk, or request additional expertise to supplement the view. So as I just mentioned, there are three levels of ownership, including the vice president level. Each risk identified, you're able to ask questions on each of those items of the VP. You're also able to request that you receive supplemental information, external, if you will, expertise to come in and review those items to provide information at your request. Also, review additional ERM information related to risk activities and strategies on an as-needed basis. This just summarizes the risk items that were discussed previously. So when we looked at the generation resource portfolio last month in May, ERM was a consideration that was factored in to that discussion. It will be included today in our discussion. OPPD Way Cost Initiative in June of this year also considered ERM in the evaluation and discussion, as did the rate restructuring and corporate operating plan, which occurred in December of last year. Just to report, there were no direct board requests for additional ERM information during the monitoring period. So the recommendation, the Finance Audit and Insurance Committee has reviewed and accepted this monitoring report for SB 15 and recommends that the board find OPPD to be sufficiently in compliance with SB 15. And then any questions or recommended or proposed revisions to the directive?
I would like to add, this is very, very important for us as a tool if you want to do risk management. As they know, we do not have this list, I think there are some things that are going to cause us to be very soon. Where I'm saying is, for example, the continuing engineering structures, that was lower because.
business plan, I'm sorry, the closeout vehicle index, expect to be at 99.5 at the end of the year. And that's a report in some sort of way. Inside the business plan, we went through all the business metrics. Two specifically that are in variance for activity management. We had a rectifier on sewer control rod that failed and we saw a good job to repair and replace for this time frame that caused it. Main operations could not select that control rod. It was an information feedback so that we could went through trending down and that would recover after the measures. Is repaired and the second area which I reported out previously is on equipment related. It's emergency diesel generator reliability and specifically the operating safety costs. Two maintenance windows in about 12 hours a month in totality for the year. This is a focus for the next year's business plan. I'm sure it was the right thing to do to take the time for some equipment, but it didn't go as planned. So those were the performance metrics of the business plan that we're doing so we covered. On budget, we did review the budget all in for nuclear. We do have a deviation on online baseline, non-outage spending, and that's driven by overtime. And to date, we're $1 million over budget. It's $1,076,000 over, predominantly driven through security staff and other operations to fire the data qualifications. So we're not staffing for the time of this time. When you look at the restart recovery non-outage, we are $239,000 under budget. On projects non-outage, we're $1.7 million under budget. And there's real savings, challenging the team to pick a milestone and sweep that money back because that goes back to the budget office. That's the savings. So total non-outage rate. When we look at outage projects, we did have a variance for the month, which we find unacceptable as we're $485,000 over budget, and that's all because of time. And we need to do better to predict our cash flow and be more transparent in the office in that area. When you look at where we are year to date, we are $530,000 under budget, but we got to improve in timing and cash flow throughout the year. And then lastly is capital projects with the cost controls teaming. With Edward's team, control power, and John and Mo helping the oversight, we are at $3.9 million under budget. We believe that's real, but there is some of that with timing there, so about half of that. So it's very well. That's it for the report.
Yeah, as far as nuclear oversight, we have three focus areas in our view this month. The first one is regarding SLT, senior leadership team at NAP. Needs to work at fully engaged during the suspensions or potential cessation of operations at the station. And although there was a corporate communications plan as well, to go further in and develop a I think Shane and his team have worked through that and have the appropriate sustainability in those discussions. The second item deals with maintenance management, being more intrusive in their oversight of the driving processes and products to ensure the work. Activities support the planned work execution. We have some had some examples where the parts are not ready for the work execution out in the field. Walk down and use better support execution. Finally, we would say that quality records for the Calhoun station need to ensure that we meet the standards. Greater there, we've had some examples where there's a 30-day requirement to give some of the records into records management. supporting the environmental conditions and the civil work and station again, sure.
We're going to tag team it just a little bit, if that's all right. So it'll be myself, Mary Fisher, who you, the board all knows, who spoke last month at the board committee as well as the board meeting. Edward Easterling will talk a little bit about the financial impacts. Mary will kind of give a briefing, a little bit of decon or decommissioning and the elements around that, because one of the recommendations that we talked to the board last month about is to bring back that recommendation on what that decommissioning methodology would be. And then I'll close it out with our final and updated recommendations, if that's okay. And I'm going to go through these relatively quickly, specifically the ones that we've already went through at last month's board committee meeting, as well as the board meeting, and all of these are on our website as well, or oppdlistens.com. But obviously the strategic directives that we have talked about regarding this recommendation around resource planning and competitive rates are driving us to take these kinds of conversations very public relative to the strategic directives. We've talked about strategic trends, whether it's cost pressures on the left, whether it's revenue growth pressures or lack thereof on the right. We're seeing those pressures kind of impact us. And so as we begin to think about the future, how do we take those into consideration? And you'll hear a little bit about that as we get to the decommissioning recommendation as well, to making sure that we think about not only regulatory flexibility, but financial flexibility as we kind of move forward and how that impacts us in the future as well. Study framework questions. Here are the questions that we essentially asked ourselves to make sure and shared with the board. What is our optimal rebalance portfolio considering many market, regulatory, and technological futures that are out there that we know of today? And I'll talk a little bit about those before I turn over the portfolio conversation to Mary. What current assets, our current assets or portfolio, remain part of any optimal future OPPD portfolio? What is the cost of keeping current assets in OPPD's future portfolio? What is the cost or benefit of delaying potential asset retirements? So some of those assets that we had identified as retiring, we're asking to bring those back in for peaking reasons, for very few hours of operations, but for peaking reasons. And what is the cost or benefit of that in that regard? Here are the technological, the technologies that we considered in the optimization review. Gas turbine combined cycles, cogen units, reciprocating engines. I think this is kind of the changing times. We didn't see this 2 years ago show up as a technology advantage. New solar, new wind, and these would be new solar, new wind without PTCs as we think about longer term, longer range. We looked at new solar, new wind relative to capacity and energy contracts in the current state. So with that would include PTCs as well. The other one that showed up, long duration batteries began to show up as a potential technology that's becoming maybe not necessarily viable today, but certainly it looks like it will have some opportunity to be integrated in the future. Energy efficiency programs, these are our demand side management initiatives that we have in place. Capacity and energy contracts, and if you remember our conversation last month, we actually went out in January with an RFP to look at both capacity and energy related contracts, because one of the things we wanted to make sure that we had in the modeling was specific and really accuracy around what those contracts would be. Not speculations, not assumptions, but real live dollars and cents relative to those kind of contracts as we would look at modeling those. And then really we looked at the extended power uprate of Fort Calhoun, adding another 15% output or another 75 megawatts. How would that impact the modeling with the Clean Power Plan or without the Clean Power Plan, depending on what happens with that. We excluded kind of new nuclear, pulverized coal and IGCC at this point in time, because of regulatory reasons, because of cost reasons, just too significant at this time. The scenarios that we investigated were really baseline. So baseline was really kind of status quo. Fort Calhoun is not retired. It extends to 2033. North Omaha 4 and 5 is converted to natural gas in 2023. And we also uprated Fort Calhoun in the model options to get it the greatest benefit of the doubt as we kind of move forward. And then we looked at it in a clean power plan scenario, and then if the clean power plan does not move forward or determines to be unconstitutional. But we believe there will be something that will follow that if that is the case, and the industry is pretty clean on that, clear on that. So what is the cost of business kind of as usual? And that's what we compare with is the baseline. And then the rebalanced are all the capacity and energy options that we would consider from a cost-effective perspective as well as from a risk perspective as well. We would keep our existing contracts relative to WAPA, Nebraska City 2, only half of Nebraska City 2 we would keep, because half of that goes to seven other parties. Any of the other PPAs that we have relative to wind today, to the extent of their contracts. We must meet a renewable target of anywhere between 30 and 50. We kind of capped it at 50, primarily for the reason of the model would continually grab it and increase it. So we wanted to cap it at least at this point in time at 50, understanding that may change in the future as well. And then the wide range of other resource alternatives, which we considered as well. And then what is this optimal portfolio from a deterministic or a net present value perspective, and then also from a risk perspective. So I'm gonna ask Mary to come up to talk a little bit about the optimized portfolio options. Again, it's some of the stuff that you've seen in the previous month, but also some changes that we've now had the opportunity to kind of vet out some of the ways that we can visually show it that may help and explain it, and some definitions around that. Edward will talk about the financial modeling. Mary will come back up and talk a little bit about the decommissioning options, and then I'll come back up for the final recommendation. I think I'll probably sit right there for the final recommendation. So. Very good. Thanks, Mary.
Thanks, Tim.
Good morning.
Good morning. So as Tim said, I'm up here to talk about portfolio capacity options. Again, I'll give you the key findings here. So Fort Calhoun drops out in every case that we ran when it's given an option. If we force it in, then obviously it's in there. The additions are economically driven, not compliance driven. The EPU is not economic. We see much cheaper alternatives out in the industry today. OPPD is in a good economic condition to meet the Clean Power Plan with or without Fort Calhoun. Now, we did constrain energy sales, as Tim mentioned a little bit earlier, just to moderate that market variability, some of that you heard from Edward this morning in terms of where we are through May. And then the stochastics did confirm lower cost and risk associated with the rebalanced portfolio. I put some definitions in here because we've had a lot of questions, both internally and externally, about what's the difference between capacity and energy. So as we go forward in this conversation, we'll have a common understanding. So capacity is the amount of electricity that a power plant is capable of producing. So it's the power plant itself. The energy is the amount of electricity that are used by our customer owners at any one moment in time. So we have to meet their requirements. And then the system requirements is the highest amount of energy that is expected to be used by our customer owners at any one moment in time during a given year. And then we have to add in the SPP mandated reserve margin, 13.6% today. We put this slide together to try to give a better understanding of what this rebalanced portfolio looked like. So we started with the baseline. This works. We started with the baseline. At the bottom of that, you see nuclear. It's the bottom block, 26%. If we take that block out, as we're proposing, everything slides down. What you see at the bottom when you slide that down is 2.5%. of our WAPA contract for hydro. You see our wind changes a bit. It goes up from 27% to 35%. Our coal goes up from 44 to 46. And our gas goes from 1 to 2%. Now, a couple of things here. These energy percentages are based on rebalancing the existing baseline portfolio. And that gas that you see up there, when we come over to the capacity, you see it went from 31 to 39%. That's really very, very economical for us to maintain because it has low cost, low fixed cost. And because of that, when it only runs 1 to 2% during the year, it's very economical for us to maintain. On the capacity side, this graph works basically the same. You take the 16% of nuclear, you slide it out, the stack drops down. I will go back and say 14% of our energy is not needed, and so we're not replacing that. We're still long, as you can see. We're meeting our OPPD system annual usage requirements. On the capacity side, again, pull out the 16% for Fort Calhoun, slide everything down. We added in 5% of the capacity contracts that we need in order to maintain our capacity requirements with SPP. You can see our wind goes up by about 1%. 33% of coal, 39% of gas. So again, we have more gas assets to be utilized. But again, they only run on those hot summer peak days, 1 to 2% of the time. And we're still meeting our system requirements by moving from a baseline to a rebalanced portfolio. Our plans for capacity contract replacements. Short term, we are proposing to run North Omaha 133 on natural gas for a longer period of time, and that's to get us through our summer peak loads. And then we're going to purchase low-cost capacity from our SPP participants. About 90% of those, the contracts that are being proposed, come from natural gas units, and 10% come from coal facilities. Long term, we want to go back and run an integrated resource portfolio this fall. We'll go through a stakeholder process, and we'll come up with a long-term alternative.
It's air and associated environmental issues, and just ongoing changes. And so I think I would maybe, Director Barrett, reserve my comment on what has changed, I think, in our mind, to after Mary's presentation, if you would, and kind of the direction I think we were kind of moving and how we're thinking about reliability, regulatory flexibility, financial flexibility is probably greater than maybe we originally kind of anticipated.
Okay.
And that's a greater position to be in, or better position to be in. Yeah, let me do it high, and then let me, John, you can talk. So, you know, if you go back to 2011 with the flood, so our transmission system and our market system experienced the loss of 481 megawatts during the 900 plus days that work everything was down. So we have some operational experience on what happens in that regard. You know, we essentially now are finishing a transmission line, 180 mile transmission line in conjunction with Kansas City Power Light that Mo has briefed the board on. That gives us even a greater access to SPP kind of marketplace energy as well. But I would say we also have seen the impacts of the match rule. And what originally was discussed in the industry was significant impacts to capacity in with match rule, whether it was in 15 when some companies decided to make an impact on their coal facilities, the older coal facilities did not, or they stopped operation in 15, we asked for a year extension just to understand the market changes so we could understand them better. And then we saw that in 16, where we really haven't seen significant changes in the marketplace relative to capacity, relative to energy costs. Still relatively low, and I think we've heard that, you know, kind of across in Edwards' financial report. So from that perspective, we do have some operating experience. We have had conversations with SPP on the transmission side. We're continually seeing growth on the transmission, whether it's us interfacing with Fremont or us interfacing with KCP&L in a 345 line, which, you know, gives us greater capability to move energy in SPP. So from that perspective, now I'll let John talk specifically and maybe more a little bit on the transmission side.
Yeah, we looked at, Director Gay sent me an article on MISO, and there were some projections that MISO makes with load growth that may be optimistic, eats up some of their capacity margin, but they are, I would say their excess capacity is much thinner or less than SPP. SPP has quite a bit of excess capacity. And to Tim's point, I think the match rule forced some, maybe a greater amount of coal retirements in the MISO region than in SPP, but I think that wave has pretty much passed for now. And now, probably the next wave would be in parallel with the Clean Power Plan, which gives us, affords us some time to bridge the gap with the capacity purchases and gas operations, and put into place the new IRP
That's exactly right. How much of the coal retirements are taking place was a clean power plan or whatever is going to happen. This is a lot more time, but as that keeps getting ratcheted down, we're always going to have a big, big decision if we're taking it, but that's the best we can at this time with information for all.
From the generation side in SPP, I think we feel very comfortable with the approach that we're recommending on the short-term contracts, and then we'll look at long-term. And some of that long-term may be to not do contracts, but we may, in the long-term strategy, you know, essentially build assets that may support it.
Yeah.
Depending on what those assets are. It could be anywhere from solar to battery to storage to combined cycle to combustion turbines to reciprocating engines on existing sites. So there's a variety of options out there that obviously we'll consider in the long term. But the short term, you know, between now and 5 years, we feel very comfortable in what we've essentially put together as a recommendation.
I have one question. As we go forward as a country, switching not only to a lot more gas, is any consideration given to the infrastructure? As we know, gas can't be stored. We can't have a whole pile, gas pile. It has to be deliverable to us. And we've had shortages in, before. Now, I know our use of gas primarily would be in the summer when and gas is primarily for heating in the home part. But is there any talk about the infrastructure of the gas delivery system then maybe on a nationwide basis?
You know, one of the maps that we showed last month was around the geographical value being in the Midwest. And we talked about the wind speeds at 80 meters and above. We talked about kind of where the Midwest is relative to connections to either Canadian gas, gas that's coming out of North Dakota, gas that's coming out of North Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas that are deep wells, as well as other fracking and other kinds of capability. And there's a significant amount of wells because of the price that are capped in it. So we know there's capacity there.
We know deliverable.
And it's deliverable. I mean, the conversations that we've had, obviously with Tenasca, but with our pipelines, Northern Natural Gas specifically, and NGPL that we interface with, just had a conversation with somebody else about you know, potential another interstate gas pipeline coming to the region, right? So we believe that capacity, the delivery capacity is not going to be an issue. Again, if you remember Mary's chart originally, the energy piece of that gas is relatively small. And again, it's in a non-peak period of time where you know, we typically don't see natural gas use for heating in our region. And so the balance of those, you know, is it fits us really well geographically.
Well, it just seems like going forward as the clean power plant or whatever replaces it, if it, we're going to eliminate most of the small nuclear power plants, or a lot of them that are at risk, and the coal is also at risk, we're going to have more and more reliance on gas, even though our parts are a little smaller.
Sure.
But you talk about the whole country doing that around the country.
Can I make one comment back to SPP and capacity discussion? I know we moved beyond it, but I want to try to give you a little more comfort. Because if you look at the modeling runs and the scenarios, all the energy that's being produced for our load is coming from OPPD assets. We're not relying on SPP to serve our load. So all the energy is being produced either by assets that we own and operate, or purchase power agreements that we have in place, and if we make SPP purchases, it's being made because it's maybe more economic at that moment to buy from the market than it is to produce. So we're not dependent on the market. Where we are dependent on the market would be the capacity. The capacity is being bought to be able to meet the requirements of SPP is established for reserves. So we're putting reserve capacity in for a time and a risk that you have extreme growth or you have allergies. You need to call upon that capacity. So if capacity is under contract, you pay the right to call in that capacity. It's dedicated to OPPD. You get the power on reserves. Before we take that contract on, we do transmission centers to look at the deliverability of that capacity to get it to our system. So there are a lot of checks and balances in here. But from an energy standpoint, energy is pretty solid. Solidly producing the energy that we need to serve. So if you take the resource out, we still have sufficient. It's the capacity that is that. contracted, studies are done to make sure that we can do it. SPP is just there as a safety net, and the market pooling mechanism to make all of this work in a more transparent way than we did to do on work. And what I would add to what Petro said is exactly right, there are two different issues. First, whether we have the capacity. The second is whether we can deliver that capacity. Now, when we look at the potential capacity that we have, we did our studies SPP, so we have to look at how the grid has a unit. Would we have some constraints, some places that we want to call that capacity? Now, our own studies showed that we were able to deliver that capacity in case we needed to store our capacity. Now, the question becomes, are we really comfortable with our own studies? We believe we are. There is an additional component now that being a part of SPP, we have to submit that request to SPP because we are in a transition moment. So we have to submit that request to SPP, and SPP will have to go through the study with the region of all SPP footprint and determine whether the potential issues in the future if we call that capacity. We believe that there won't be issues, but we won't know until we submit that request. And typically, it takes about 6 months for that integrated study to be utilized. But as Tim indicated, we have a talking to SPP, and they have a process. It's a three-day process where they more like a screener process to look, whether there is a potential issue or not. So far, it's been very positive. It's been very good. But again, we need to be, we won't know 100% for that integrated study is completed, which takes about 6 months. In all days, it used to take 2 years. Now it takes about 6 months. So overall, from our perspective, we're very comfortable that we can deliver that capacity if we need it. We continue to talk to us, and we'll see what we
and I'll also add, recognizing and realizing that one of the reasons why we're proposing to use Northern Park is short term, because there is no transmission risk for that. So that's not only is it low cost to do that, but it's also eliminating transmission risk.
Yeah, and we're contracting with SPP for capacity. For the contract with them, so that's guaranteed to us. Is that like an annual thing, or is that ongoing, or is there an after year? Is there any chance we could lose the ability to acquire that capacity?
The capacity agreements are with specific utilities. It's not with SPP. Okay. So it's company X or company Y. For specific resources that they make available to us in the process. So you have to know where it's coming from transmission. And it'll have a term. 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, whatever you contract for. So there is a defined term, and there's a defined company, and it's a
cost of the thing.
Not if it's phase one.
Yeah, I think what we're finding based on the net present value. It's actually very cost effective because of there's half excess capacity in the marketplace. People are wanting big capacity payments for. We need capacity, but the cost is much less than the alternative that we do by the one. This example,
I would also add this to make sure that we're not concerned about that. Even after 6 months of work, if SPP comes back, they're not going to say we can't do it. They're going to say, you may need to do some improvement at this site, or you may need to add transport at this substation. So, of course, it would be that kind of issue. So, there's a lot of comfort.
that's what it's affordable to provide. So,
well, this is, I mean, this is really interesting on this, you know, on the strategic directive that the board, you know, approved a year ago. Is that, as I've told different groups, not one of these strategic directives stand alone. They're all integrated, right? So as we think about resource planning, we also have one around reliability that includes not only the distribution system, but our other generating units as well. It also includes, you know, site security and security protection and a variety of other things as well. So all of these are interrelated that kind of drive us to make sure that these are well-balanced recommendations that we're providing.
So, a bit about decommissioning. The NRC defines it as the process of safely closing a nuclear power plant and retiring it from service after its useful end. The process is primarily driven by decontaminating the facility to reduce residual activity, leasing the property for unrestricted use. It often includes dismantling the facility or repurposing the facility. It begins after the nuclear fuel is removed from the core, and the regulations and the NRC maintain their oversight to ensure that we protect the workers and the public as we've done in the past. Two alternatives that we focused on, decom and safe store. Decom is defined as immediate dismantlement of the facility, so you remove the fuel from the core, let it decay off into the fuel pool, and then move to dismantling the facility immediately. Safe store is often referred to as deferred dismantlement. You remove your fuel from the core, let it decay off, and then you put the plant in a situation where you can maintain it for the long term, and then come back and actually dismantle it. I will say that the term of that safe store alternative is not defined other than it needs to be completed within 60 years. So some utilities have waited 5, some utilities have waited 10, some utilities have waited 20. That is a sliding scale, and it gives you some flexibility in making determinations. And then a tomb where the radioactive contaminants are encased in a structurally sound materials such as concrete, and that's not typically used in the U.S., so we really focused on decon and safe store. A little bit of history where the industry has been. There's 29 reactors that are currently or have gone through decommissioning. About 59% are through decon, and I put an asterisk on that because a number of reactors have completed this decon, but they have started off in safe store and then moved to. Others have gone immediately into decon, so it's been done differently with different utilities based on their needs. The four recent announcements and those that are currently in decommissioning, Crystal River, Kewaunee, San Onofre, 2 and 3, units 2 and 3, and then Vermont Navy. Three of those have chosen safe store, one has gone into decon. A little bit about our decommissioning funding. We have a minimum required NRC decommissioning fund of $285 million. This fund was put in place to meet our decommissioning requirements at the end of the license support happening in 2033. As of last year, that was fully funded, should be shut down in 2033. Obviously, we're talking about a different proposal here, and I'll show you how we're going to fund that in the future. And then supplemental decommissioning fund, that's really there for your spent for fuel and your site restoration, and that balance is $96 million. Our incremental funding, we shut down early, we will need incremental funding. It's really a blend of savings from our operations and maintenance from not running the facility. Associated earnings associated with both of these funds, which are currently invested, and then our spent fuel management reimbursements from DOE. DOE is obligated to take our fuel. We have a contract with them to get reimbursements for those activities. What that looks like, I put both safe store and decon on this slide. At the top, you see decommissioning. decommissioning expenses cumulative over the course of the years. So we start off in 2016, should the board approve this recommendation. And in about 2026 on the decon scenario, you see that start to flatten out. What that is our spent fuel storage, our spent fuel needs to stay in storage until the DOE comes to take it from us, or is or can take it from us. And so that maintains. We've made an estimate that DOE will be able to take that in 2050. And so at the bottom, you see that look down there. That's DOE when you're taking your fuel up, and then you have to decommission the independent spent fuel storage installation once it's installed. In terms of safe storage, you can see that's a longer period of time. But I will reiterate on the bottom slide, you see those curves really kind of following each other. In the first 5 years of safe store or decon, you're basically doing the same activities. And so that's why you see those curves mirroring each other. You see over a term of 60 years, so we analyze the bookings, do it immediately, do it within 60 years. And again, you see that growing decommissioning expense for safe store. That's really maintaining our fuel until at the end you see an uptick, and that's really coming back to you at the deferred dismantlement that I spoke of earlier. And you see that on the bottom graph as well. You see kind of that plateau where we're maintaining the plant site and the fuel for safe store. And then at the end, we back and dismantle the facility. And at that time, turn the fuel and the DOE and dismantle the facility as well. We had a lot of questions about the funding. Can we really fund this? This slide is a bit complicated, a bit busy, but I'll try to go through it as best I can. The bars that are below zero represent the expenses that we've estimated for decommissioning both for safe store and decom. The green bars on top are how we expect to fund this. So these are contributions from operations as well as the funding and the interest from the funds. And then those decommissioning, spent fuel reimbursements from DOE. So those are the funding mechanisms. The gray shaded areas represent how our fund is being used either in decon or safe store. So at decon, you see we're drawing down that pretty consistently. And in 2015, you see that loan to balance going to zero. In safe store, you see we start off, we put it into a safe store, safe storage period. We continue to grow that fund. And then at the end, you'll see in 2075, we have a lot of expenses that come in. And then we drop that fund down to zero as well. So what this shows is two different funding mechanisms, one for safe store and one for decom. So how did we come and what was the methodology? How did we make this decision? We looked at three major categories. We looked at financial stewardship, we looked at safety and regulatory, and we looked at customer owner, community, and companies, trying to understand how it impacts all of us. In terms of financial stewardship, and we're talking a little bit about the financial flexibility, we want to make sure that we can maintain our flexibility to adjust for any of those unknowns that we spoke about earlier. It does give us corporate financial health, better health, as Edward went through in the main meeting. And then we also looked at talent and project execution. It's very important as you go into a decommissioning project that you have the right expertise, that you bring in decommissioning expertise. It's different than an operator. And so we wanted to make sure we balanced that, we discussed it. Safety and regulatory, we looked at nuclear safety, we looked at radiological safety, we looked at environmental safety, industrial safety, and regulatory safety. And what that means to us is we need to understand how all of these things are coming together to make sure that we make the right decision for all of those criteria. Regulatory flexibility is one of the basic elements. Sure that we have the ability to adjust as you run into any of those, again, unknowns that Edward spoke of earlier, and that falls in line with the financial flexibility of the board. And then we looked at how is this impacting not only our customer owners, but our community and our employees in particular. Customer owners and stakeholder perspectives were discussed, as well as our corporate reputation and what this means to our OPPD family, and so all of these things were taken into account. The two that weigh really significant in this decision are the financial flexibility and the regulatory flexibility. So in conclusion, what I would say, as we went through this discussion, we sat in a room, 10 to 12 of us, for about 3 days discussing all of these criteria. And we found that both decommissioning methodologies were very close. As we went, we could say one would weigh one way, one would weigh the other way. We come back the next day and we would have thought of other things. And at the end of the day, we said they're really very close. But it really centers around that flexibility that I just spoke of, the regulatory and the financial flexibility. And because of that, we believe that safe store brings greater value to our customer owners, and that would be the recommendation.
Just with that, certainly we have our team do that. We'll use some outside experts as well. We talked to Lynn, who's here from Vermont, who's been working with us through this process. David Oldley and many of the board members know, who's been actively involved in that. And then obviously, with McKinsey and some of the work that they've done internationally, around the world, around using decommissioning, we've got them sit down with several of us just to step through what that looks like. And all of the conversations that we've had, including our partners with Exelon, became very clear that the direction that gives us the greatest regulatory flexibility and financial flexibility is really to look at safe store. I would say that and then say we would look at probably some hybrid without defining what that hybrid looks like. So we would look at safe store, we would work our way through the first several years of our safe store activity, and then begin to put together our decon plan as we begin to progress and see how we perform in those first several critical years, and put together that decon plan and what that would look like. I guess our thought today would be not to take 60 years to do that, but we want to make sure we have the financial flexibility and regulatory flexibility. The difficulty with going with decon, Director Barry, you asked the question, what has kind of what changes have you thought about as you went through this? I think you were kind of moving down the decon perspective right away and thought that would be the best option. But understanding the financial flexibility and regulatory flexibility, it's tough to move to decon and then back up and go to safe store, right? So you don't have that regulatory flexibility to do that. And so we've seen folks that have gone to safe store and then accelerated their decon and more of this hybrid approach. We've seen more of them doing that to give them the regulatory flexibility. Matter of fact, in one of the conversations that we had with someone in the field was you don't really even need to identify which direction you're going for 2 years. Right? Well, we think it's important to share that not only inside the company but outside the company about what our recommendation would be around this. And so our point would be recommendation would be safe store within the next 2 to 3 years as we move to move fuel, the spent fuel pool, that we would begin to work on that decon plan and come back and share some of the clarity about what that looks like and the timing of what that looks like. As we begin to fund, greater fund, the decommissioning fund that will be required for us to continue down that strategy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions about the
decommissioning?
Thank you.
So our overall recommendation, as we essentially talked with the board last month and obviously talked throughout the organization last month, would be what has not changed is the six operations that worked at home by December 31st, and we would begin to work through the operating folks and the regulators and what that would look like between now and the end of the year. Our decommissioning methodology recommendation is to pursue safe store, which is pretty consistent with the industry norms that we've seen, which would give us that regulatory and financial flexibility, that we would not have any projected general rate increases through 2021. We did kind of our plan on our commitment to get to 20% over the regional average by 2020. That would be that, even with some of the changes we can see in the fuel purchase power adjustments now that we modeled it. The accounting treatment that Edward spoke of on the pieces around that, we would be going to the rating agencies very shortly, in the next couple of weeks, and kind of presenting our plan around that. That we would look at pursuit of our rebalance portfolio options. I'm going to talk about the short-term capacity replacement first, that we would utilize units 1, 2, and 3 on natural gas during these peak periods. We have the capability to do that, the capacity to do that, and we would have that in place for several years, let's say, until we find longer-term solutions around that. And that we would purchase available low-cost capacity that we've modeled through our optimized portfolios and talked with you over the last 7 months about it. Then on the long-term side, and I'm not sure what long-term is anymore. You know, we used to do integrated resource plans that were 20 years long. And then, you know, we went out and did a 20-year plan 2 years ago, and now we see changes based on what's occurring. So I think long-term is relative. And even though for Western Area Power Agency we have to perform an integrated resource plan every 5 years and get public report and file that with them, and my guess is as technology changes, as industry changes, you know, we'll look at an ongoing way to keep live our integrated resource plan and make sure that we're optimizing both from a cost and a risk perspective our resource portfolio and how that impacts ratings, how that impacts reliability. All the discussions that we had here today. So that would be our recommendations. That would be in the item Thursday morning for
questions.
I'm sorry, because the comments here, you know, gas buildings, some of the people who are using this, and as we're having discussions, and the other non-host questions.
Sure they understand what our recommendation is and what it impacts, and some of the myths that kind of show up in these recommendations that we as a team have done the deep dive on and vetted out very clearly, but you know, the questions have been very good and the conversations have been very good, and you know, not to, I would say the struggle that the senior team have had. And in the video that I provided to the employees yesterday is about you know, the people issues. Is concerned about that, and, but we've been able to maintain, you know, our nuclear safety, and we'll need to have the employees be able to do that. But that's been, you know, the difficulty with this. And when people, you know, it's easy for people to, I'm just going to say this, it's easy for people to Monday morning quarterback, but These are big decisions, and I just want to say the senior team and a variety of the other management team around this have dived deep into this, so we feel that comfortable with this recommendation, but it has been over a period of months that We have challenged ourselves internally. We've had external audiences challenges. And then obviously, you know, now we're in this setting where we have public challenging us and employees challenging us. But I think we've really addressed all the issues that we've identified in this recommendation. And the senior team as a collective group, I think, would agree this is the right direction. We've done it as a team, as well as extended out to critical leaders in the organization, whether it's on transmission, whether it's on supply, whether it's on decommissioning, whether it's on some of the economic development pieces that we're doing too. I had a great conversation with an individual after the Blair City Council who said, you know, this was going to be inevitable at some point in time. You're right, it's 17 years earlier or 15 years earlier, and the difficulty is we knew this was going to happen at some point in time. The deal is it's 15 years earlier. How do we address all that? But those same impacts that would have occurred in 2030, 31, 32, 33 are just happening at a more accelerated rate. And that's our challenge, and that's our ongoing commitment to the communities that we serve. I can tell you from the economic development side, we're trying to drive increased business in this area as well. I mean, I just reported that the Chamber Board, we have a project that project, a large manufacturing project that has a potential of 1,500 employees to 5,000 employees, and Omaha is being considered as one of those sites. And I can say that because we've talked about it at the change of board. But it's that kind of project and a variety of projects like that that I think will still create a vibrant community, and certainly the skilled and educated employees. Director McGuire, just as you said, have articulated concerns or issues or messages on the Facebook site and in the OPPD listens and in emails and letters to the board, to the management team, will be highly sought after in this community as we kind of move through this process if that's a direction the board wants us to move to. And so we stand ready to support that personally, professionally, and as an organization to do what we need to do to help our employees transition, for those that need the transition, and for those that will continue the operations and the support, and we'll support them continually as well.
Any other thoughts?
Thanks to Mary and Edward and the whole team for all the good hard work they've done.
That's standard, John. Thank you.
We also appreciate Shane.
Sure. And keeping the team together because we still have to, have a safe plant and that'll be, I think Shane and the team, are working very hard to make sure that we maintain our nuclear professionalism and excellence mission, which is, one who reminds us very clearly that, but we also understand that he has that expectation, and he's given that expectation as part of our relationship with Exelon and the management team that's here as well to continue to focus, as we will still continue the operations through the end of the year. I'll certainly make that note very, very clear with the employees as we meet with them tomorrow and then Thursday afternoon.
This is a small meeting, it's not really a public meeting, public newspaper. But on Thursday, are we going to go through all this again? Because it will be streaming. I think employees, say, well, we have to have some small analysis. But I agree with you. I think they should see this one more time. Are we going to work on Thursday?
Our plan, we would probably have a modified presentation, but we would still, the meat of the presentation will be there on Thursday again. And then what we did last month and what we'll do this month and our commitment to the employees is one, we heard very clearly, was if you could share what the recommendation is going to be on the decommissioning methodology, just share us what the recommendation is. I mean, I think Lisa and the team heard this very clearly. And so we shared what our recommendation was going to be today with the employees yesterday, very clearly, as they were meeting upset in the manner in which things happened to kind of roll out last month. And so we took that earnestly and said, we're just going to communicate what our recommendation is. We weren't going to wait until after this meeting, although the board has the ability to do whatever you need to do. But we will also have the employees that want to have the capability to live stream it at different locations throughout our service territory. And we'll make sure that employees have the opportunity, and they greatly appreciate the opportunity last month to be part of that. And we've heard that over and over again by employees. And so this is that big of a decision that impacts the whole organization, and we think they need to see the interaction, the interface, and the discussion, and the dialogue in what we're going to be presenting on Thursday as well. So thanks.
All right. Rich, anything else? Thank you. We're going to move on. Director Ulrich.
Mr. Chairman, believe it or not, we don't have a reporting on him on purchases over $500,000, and it's the first time I can remember that's going to happen. We do have one action item. Provide a transformer for one of the busiest streets in OPPD territory, Grand Road, and I'll let Mr. Galvin explain.
This board action item is for the purchase of a power transformer of the size of about 30 MVA, which is typical for our substations. It is required for substation 1278, located on 84th and Schwann, mainly for increased load. We have six proposals, and all of them were legally responsive, and we were technically responsive in delivery of this transformer. If you do approve the purchase of it, will be sometime in March of 17. The whole project will be completed by June of 2017. We're recommending the approval to go ahead and purchase this transformer from CG Systems USA. They're in Missouri. I had a really good experience with them. And the amount of $620,000 on $620,400, excuse me. And I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have any.
Well, I have a question. So 84th Tram, we already have a transformer there. Is this an additional one?
That's correct. We already have a substation there. We have a transformer. Right. And we plan those that will happen as we need to.
So it's just going to be like a shadow lake area.
Correct.
That's it. I have one other thing. There's a security. There's another part of the team here as far as outages. And last Friday, there was an outage in Midtown related to an underground bus fire. Not a bus fire, an underground fire. As far as the transformer that caught on fire, and it affected most of Midtown area, right?
So
that's a good one.
It's always good, it's healthy, the healthy.
That can require you to have anything like that.
Yes, I do. I have a motion to go into closed session. To discuss any litigation matters and update the strategy discussion regarding the working matters and labor contracts. With respect to any litigation matters or discussion of these matters, and as we advise that is covered by the 29 which we require to protect by the city or product of respect.
Negotiations and labor contracts. No vote on the board action will be taken. Thank you all for coming.